Dear colleagues, we are approaching, unfortunately, the end of our program. This is the closing session of the symposium. We had discussions, most of the time agreements, but if we put two judges together, there will be five different theories. So we can never count on full agreement, but that's the beauty of law and that's the beauty of humanity, the diversity of us or in among us. It's now time to announce the two co-chairs of this session. First, my dear colleague and friend, José Igreja Matos, the president of the International Association of Judges, president of the Porto Supreme Court. Everybody's already volunteering to visit you in Porto. And you know, it's because of the beauty and the wine and the cuisine and everything that that magnificent part of Portugal can offer. It's the first time that we have a president of the International Association that understands the importance of environmental law, and especially of climate change. And it was Justice Igreja that so many years ago at Iguazu Falls welcomed Elizabeth Mrema, me, Justice Ricardo Lorenzetti. We were in a delegation, but more like intruders in the biannual or triannual conference of the International Association of Judges. And there we were to propose to the board that they helped us with the foundation of the Global Judicial Institute on Environment. I don't need to give you the details, but it was not an easy meeting, to our surprise, until the then president of the Association of Judges, of European Judges, Justice Igreja, said, "Mr. President, I think this is an excellent idea, and that the International Association of Judges should walk hand in hand with this new emerging institution that we call the Global Judicial Institute on Environment." So there is a long history of collaboration between him and our institute, because it began before the institute was even founded. The second co-chair is Professor Christina Voigt. You already had the privilege to listen to her as a keynote speaker, a distinguished law professor at the University of Oslo Law School. I would say, if I were to list the three finest experts on climate law, Christina Voigt would be one of them. Both of them have a quality that we also find in the two speakers, keynote speakers. And that is integrity and dedication to the public interest. So the two keynote speakers, and they will be introduced by the co-chairs, but I cannot resist saying one word or two about them. And Thomas Clark, the general counsel of ADB, has already heard me saying those things in private about those two people. Both Achim Steiner and Elizabeth Mrema are giants in environmental law and development law. And I will begin with you, Achim Steiner. Yesterday, Inga Andersson closed the session of the first day. And I said that when she was the director of IUCN, the project that she liked the most was the Global Judicial Institute on Environment. And we were so lucky to have in another continent the director of UNEP, who immediately said, this is fantastic, let's do it. And I vividly remember when I went to Bakari County to your office to present the idea of the Global Judicial Institute on Environment. And then you participated in many of our activities. Elizabeth Mrema was the director of the law program at UNEP. And from day one, I didn't even ask her. I just invited her. And I knew that we would be together working with judges globally, doing capacity building, and making sure that the family would be together. Not uniform, but together. So I'm very grateful to Elizabeth Mrema, as I said yesterday when I introduced it, Patricia Mimborti. Those are the colleagues that we have here with us today. I do hope that in such a complicated time that we live, violence, the number of vulnerable people increasing instead of decreasing, that we judges continue to have the support of people like the ones that we have here. And I see Bruno Oberli sitting there too. Your turn is later. Those are partners like Tom Clark and the ADB and the European Reconstruction and Development Bank. On that very short introduction, I had so much to say, but I think when we are among friends, the most important thing to say is just thank you. A word of gratitude. So please welcome our guests and our co-chairs.
I sit here. Go back. So I don't know. So good afternoon. Arriving a few hours from the airport, just arriving, and very important for me to be here. I put a lot of pressure in myself, in my agenda, to be honored to be in this event, because I think international associations that judges should be here and must be here. And that is why I change all my schedule and happily arrive on time to be addressing some words to you. First of all, to Minister Antonio Benjamin, a dear friend, thank you. Thank you for your work. Thank you for your efforts. It is really remarkable what you are doing. I think environmental, the topic of environmental climate change is the future of the planet is absolutely essential. And we are judges, we are the judiciary, we represent a power of the state. We cannot be neutral, we cannot be like trying to throw a blind eye to the problem. So this is why when I was elected in September in Rome, as I was telling to a little bit ago, when I was elected in Rome in September, I put some priorities for my mandate. One was gender. That is another issue that is very concerning to us. And among others, the problem of environment. And to see that exist all these wonderful people, judges working on this issue for years now, and to know them, to have the possibility of be with them, work with you, it's a privilege for me. And I see so many familiar faces already since the beginning of my mandate. I have the fortune of meeting some of you already. And well, I'm losing the my role here. So my main thing is to introduce you to the distinguished speakers. I have some common sense, I think. So I decided to deliver to much more skilled Christina Voigt co-share this work, and for me just to give you these welcome words and thank you for the opportunity of being here. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And it's a great pleasure for me to co-chair this panel together and to introduce, of course, our keynote speaker. Says perhaps not so much more to say after Antonio introduced you already, but I would like to first invite our dear friend Achim Steiner. Achim is currently the administrator of the United Nations Development Program. He also was the executive secretary, director of UNEP for several years. And he also was the director general of the IUCN. And when Inga was here last night, Antonio asked her if that was her most difficult job that she's ever had. But I spare you this question because we have the current DG here in the room. Don't want to put you in any dangerous position, Bruno. So then I'm sure it was a wonderful job that you had. Very important. Achim is a friend, I hope I can say that, of the legal community, is a friend of the legal community. It's a double friend. He has been supportive, as Antonio said, of the work of the World Commission on Environmental Law under the IUCN for many, many years. But the interesting aspect with Achim is that he combines both the environment, but also the development agenda, both in his work and in his engagement with the WCL and the Global Judicial Institute of the Environment. And I assume, and I'm sure you'll come back to that, Achim, that this combined expertise makes you to appreciate very much the role of law in addressing both the environmental and development challenge that we have. The need for robust laws, the need for courts, the need for justice in both addressing environmental challenges, but also the development agenda. Achim, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your kind introduction. And I want to begin by just saying, yes, I'm very proud to be a friend because I'm not a learned friend, just a friend, but a very passionate one, and one who owes a great deal of his understanding and appreciation of the role of law and the rule of law, the environmental rule of law, to our dear friend, Antonio Benjamin, who sits here. I think, Antonio, you thank so many people so often because you are one of the great conveners in the world. You are one of the great pipers of Hameln, I think, as one would say in this part of the world, where you are able to not only excite with the vision that you have, but you then have the audacity to actually make it happen. You know, we are meeting 50 years after Stockholm convened here. And there will be Greta and others out there who will say words, words, words. And your profession is also very well known for being very verbose sometimes. So, with all the humility that I can bring to being in this exciting group of people who have come together here to reflect on that Stockholm Declaration and how our understanding, how our appreciation of the rule of law, but also of environmental jurisprudence, and the symposium in Rio will never be forgotten by any of us, I think, who attended it in the Supreme Court of Rio de Janeiro, in that fantastic building. It was historical. It was epochal in a sense, because it marked a next beginning in a long journey. So in my 7 minutes, of which I've already invested 2.5 by now, let me just briefly reflect on the moment in time which we find ourselves. Yes, it's Stockholm plus 50. And let me also say, let's, before we start worrying about all the things that haven't happened, just pause for a moment and celebrate those who made 1972 happen. And every year since, built on what, in a sense, happened in 1972, which was to emancipate a reality that for so long had simply been considered secondary, tertiary. The concerns of those who depended on the environment being considered to be less relevant than those who actually had no more relationship with the environment, because water comes out of a tap, electricity comes out of a socket, my food is in the supermarket. Why are you talking about nature? What has environment got to do with my 21st century dream of life in the universe of technology and the cornucopia that, in a sense, that second half of the 20th century suggested to us? Well, here we are, 1972, the conference happened, institutions were founded, generations of environmental agreements have since evolved from it. I was surprised that there are not 1,000 already, because by the time I left UNEP, there were over 500 multilateral environmental agreements, and my briefing note says there's still about 500. So have we hit the ceiling? Or maybe, Elizabeth, you can enlighten us on that in a moment. But it's an extraordinary body of achievement, because what we have created is not only an environmental agenda, we have also created the foundations for mutual accountability, because that's what multilateral environmental agreements create. The foundations for nations, sovereign nations, to agree with each other on what needs to be done, to agree with one another of what each one will do, and to be able to hold one another accountable. It's an element also of that environmental governance, and sometimes then codified into the environmental rule of law. So I think the 50 years since the Stockholm Declaration did indeed provide vital tracks along which countless professionals, first of all, maybe those who are advocating on behalf of the environment, but then increasingly also the profession of lawyers, of attorney generals, of judges, essentially having to evolve, and this was very much the theme in Rio also, an entirely new generation of jurisprudence, an environmental or environmentally informed jurisprudence. Where I want to end up with these brief remarks is that as we meet here at Stockholm plus 50, also is a reminder that in some ways, the way that the environmental community, and I'm sure many of you reflect on this daily, has to evolve its approach to dealing with what are often now dilemmas in our world. Stockholm was defined by, in a sense, a very binary debate. Poverty and environment, privilege versus the inability to act on issues. Well, our world has become so much more complicated. And the ability to transact decisions in our societies through our judicial system has become so much more prominent. And it is not just the disputes over a particular territory. We are now dealing with an entire generation that is stepping in front of the courts of their countries, the constitutional courts, with an intergenerational challenge. Not only are we dealing with the complexity of an environmental jurisprudence that has to deal with issues that most of us might have maybe heard about last time we were in school, carbon dioxide, the NOx, the SOx, methane emissions, and suddenly, all of this and much more has to become part of a jurisprudence that is not only the product of one judge or one court, but indeed becomes the foundations for an environmental rule of law. But where I want to end up is that I think we have to even go broader. And this is partly where the confluence of Stockholm+50, but also the emergence of the Sustainable Development Agenda, and in some ways codified through 2015 and the Sustainable Development Goals and the 2030 Agenda, I think are a vital reminder that in this day and age, the best way in which to, first of all, understand what it is to have a right that relates to environment, but to have that right also understood within the totality of our society's daily decision-making, if I may put it in those terms, where an individual is not defined by one-third environment, one-third social, one-third economics, but where some of the economics of an individual is totally compromised by an environmental destruction, and the other way around. Sustainable development law may not be the right terminology, but somewhere in there is the further evolution of an environmental rule of law paradigm that has to continue to evolve alongside fundamental interpretations of human rights. And not only when human rights or environmental defenders are locked up, are killed in the defense of these rights, but also in the interpretation of how, in a world where access to resources, depriving others of that access, or destroying resources in the name of development, of progress, does increasingly become truly a crime, sometimes a crime against your neighbor, sometimes a crime against the next generation. How do we evolve our thinking in terms of law, governance, into an era where I think people will increasingly turn to you as judges, attorneys general, courts, in order to not arbitrate, but to determine what is defensible or what is constitutionally acceptable, or where does constitutional law also have to evolve in order to accommodate this? A few years ago in 2017, I was invited by the World Bank's annual, I think, environmental law conference it's called. And I spoke at that time already about something that fascinated me, namely that young people who in many courts are not even considered to be adults and therefore are not necessarily even entitled to approach the court, were beginning to take the issue of climate change right to the heart of a country's constitutional ruling, namely the Supreme Courts. We have since then seen that happen in many countries, and we have seen green courts in India. We have seen many, in a sense, judicial platforms emerge on which people who feel they have nothing left but to turn to law and to jurisprudence to, first of all, be heard, and secondly, to be understood in terms of what they're actually saying. Your role as judges, the further evolution of this notion of the rule of law in the context of a sustainable development era that is still largely defined more by the failure to really achieve turnarounds than by breakthroughs, makes you sometimes literally the last person you can turn to in our societies. Working with you and working in where I am at the moment as head of the United Nations Development Programme, as you said just now, I work daily at the confluence of something that science tells me and that in the next moment I'm told economic imperatives contradict. That kind of trade-off belongs to the last century. It is simply no longer viable. It's not tenable. And I believe that through law and jurisprudence, we create the new rules of the game, because it is only when we change the rules of the game will the outcomes be different. In that spirit, may the force be with you. Totally inappropriate term in this room, but I mean it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Achim. Thank you for reminding us of the fact that the world has become more complex in those 50 years. How relations have become more complex, the challenges we're facing have become more dire, and that all calls to the stage the rule of law to create an answer and to define, redefine, reimagine the rules of the game. Thank you so much, Achim. Our second speaker, and again, a wonderful friend of our community, of the legal community, is Elisabeth Maruma Mrema. Elisabeth is a lawyer and a career diplomat, a wonderful combination. Elizabeth is currently the executive secretary of the Convention on Biological Diversity. And many of you perhaps know that currently, pretty much as we speak, the parties to the Convention on Biological Diversity are negotiating what is called the Global Biodiversity Framework, which is supposed, hopefully, to be adopted in the course of this year at a conference of the parties, which is not defined yet where it will take place. But it's absolutely crucially important work. Some have coined it as the Paris Agreement for Nature. It is a set of global targets, which hopefully put a halt to the decline of biodiversity loss and nature destruction. Elizabeth was the director of the law division of UNEP, and she actually worked at UNEP for more than two decades. So you probably have seen it all in Nairobi. Elizabeth was also the executive secretary of the Convention on the Conservation of Migratory Species. So she has been involved in guiding these negotiations and these global meetings for many, many years. Elizabeth is a long-standing member of the steering committee of the World Commission on Environmental Law. Antonio got her in and I kept her. There was no way losing Elizabeth. She was also, for her work in the field of environmental law for nature protection, she was awarded last year in 2021 with the Nicholas Robinson Award for Excellence in Environmental Law. It's a WCL and UNEP combined award, and a very, very deserved award. Elizabeth, the floor is yours.
You see, my former boss says he was not invited to the party. And I'm saying it was a virtual party. Thank you very much, first, for the invitation to be here. I'm not sure if I deserve all those compliments, but what I think I'm always, especially now, to be here. And I was counting, for those who might not know, it is actually 26 years from the time when we first began engaging judges on environmental law issues. 1996, that's when we began in UNEP. At the time, I recall very well, judges were telling us, you cannot train judges. So don't be surprised when you see Symposium. So we got all, you cannot train judges, you cannot call judges. I mean, we were really criticized that particular meeting, and it was in Kisumu, Kenya. So after that, we changed the name into colloquium, symposium, interactive, and you can see it is still retained today. But delighted that development 1996 is what led to today, the Global Judicial Institute on Environment. Is what led before the Global Institute, really development of environmental justice, not just at national level in many countries, at regional level in Asia, led by Asia Development Bank. You have mentioned the region, the role of Brazil played. You have mentioned how we are able to get environment as part of the agenda of the International Judges Association. So 26 years of those development, I think it's great today to be here to see that development and to also see the development, not just of the environmental judicial activism, but also to see the growth of specialized courts on environment in many countries today. And I recall UNEP had even published, by the time we did a compilation of environmental courts chambers, we already had over 1,000, and that's a few years, or probably now several years ago. So I know now probably the number has doubled. So first, congratulations
to the judges. We've come a long way, but delighted that now you have recognized you cannot be trained, yes, but you interpret the law, you make the law, you push governments to take action. And all the environmental challenges we are talking today, those actions on the ground, this is where we hope we will be able to see the environmental judicial activism coming on board. Where are we now 50 years after Stockholm 1972? First, unfortunately, we need to take note that the world is still struggling to save itself from the consequences of the multiple environmental crises. It's climate change, it's biodiversity loss, it is land sea degradation, it is pollution, and the list goes on. The problems of 1972, which led to the establishment of UNEP, are still the problems we have today. In fact, probably I don't want even to say they've doubled, I don't know whether they've, but clearly the challenges have even increased, and probably all of us here need to ask ourselves, what are we doing, whether it's as a judge, as from development, from environmental sector, whichever situation, are we doing the right thing? And if we are not doing the right thing, what are we doing wrong? What will it change now, next 50 years? By then, probably most of us might not be on this world. But then, if 50 years is where we are, what are we saying the next 10, 20, 30 to another 50 years? I think that's the question we need to ask ourselves. And when I'm in front of judges, this is where I think you come in. Those who are responsible with all the pollution, the changes in climate, the land degradation, we know them. They are brought to your courts. Then what happened? I leave it to you. But we also know a lot has happened in the last 50 years. And Achim has mentioned the growth of the development of multilateral environmental agreements. 500 is just a working number. Literature will say 1,000. So clearly we don't know the number, but the fact remains there are just too many out there. But what can we say about their implementation and enforcement? It's a different question. But what's the fact still remains that we have actually reached these planetary tipping points of unprecedented scale in the history of humankind. This is what the scientists have clearly told us. In this 50-year-long history and process, we have also witnessed the role of judges, how it has been crucial in supporting, in elaborating, in enforcing environmental rules, standards to what we call today environmental rule of law, which again was a term coined by UNEP in those days, again criticized even 2012 when we brought about again global judges during the Rio plus 20, but delighted finally the UN Environment Assembly agreed to the methodology. Now we can delightfully use it. But then let me be selfish and focus on the role of the judiciary in the implementation of the long-term post-2020 global biodiversity framework, which is currently being negotiated, because that will be part of the projection of the global efforts and commitment in the next 50 years of human society to live in harmony with nature. Just at coffee break, there was a discussion of climate action for judges, and I was criticized. You cannot talk of climate without biodiversity. You cannot talk of climate without pollution, chemicals, or land degradation. So I think we need to change the narrative. because when you talk of climate, we'll be talking of floods, we'll be talking of earthquake, disasters, and what have you. Which ecosystem are they operating, if not on biodiversity? And we all know the Convention of Biological Diversity, our own convention, as we are celebrating 50 years Stockholm, the Rio conventions, climate change, desertification, and our biodiversity celebrating this year 30 years since that Rio 1992. So yes, it's an international treaty. Yes, universal, almost 196 minus two countries plus European Union. So there's that universal acceptance. But 30 years, we are still today being told loss of biodiversity has reached unprecedented rates. So I don't know whether we are doing something or we've not done anything, but the figures from the recent scientific reports are worrying. Clearly, despite decades of conservation and protection of biodiversity, destruction of ecosystem, loss of biodiversity, even as we sit here, continue unabated. Climate change is equally exacerbating this loss of biodiversity, which in turn, of course, diminishes the ability to adapt to climate change and mitigate its effects. It is the realization of this existential threat of losing our own life support system that prompted the world to embark on the development of the new global biodiversity framework, which will be the successor of the strategic biodiversity plan and its targets, popularly known as the Aichi biodiversity targets of the last decade. The new global biodiversity framework, yes, is anticipated to serve or to be at par with the climate Paris Agreement, which was adopted way back in 2015, for which we are still struggling with its implementation. So again, we are not doing well. And I think I was in an event this morning where it was mentioned the temperatures are actually now at 3.1, when we are supposed to go into 1.5. So we still have a long way to go. The development of the Global Biodiversity Framework is at an advanced stage. Its scope will be global, even if, although it is being negotiated by the parties to the convention, but the negotiation process has engaged all stakeholders, and I mean all stakeholders. If there's anything positive to the development process has been the extra time we're able to get during this COVID period, because as we're all locked down, we're able then to consult virtually all stakeholders, financial institutions, business, private sector, indigenous peoples, local communities, youth, women, and all can see themselves in the draft framework as it stands now. And of course, we need to know that the framework, when it is adopted, will immensely contribute to the implementation of the Climate Paris Agreement and also contribute to the achievement of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. If you look at the 17 SDGs, one has to tell me which one goal is not biodiversity related. I just need one, which is not biodiversity related. So clearly, if then the biodiversity conservation and protection does not happen, clearly then the SDGs, well celebrated, will not be achieved. And because of the loss of biodiversity, not surprising that also SDGs, we are still not yet there, and the years are drawing closer to 2030. So we are fully cognizant, based on the 50 years of record, that judiciary is a key ally in advancing not just all environmental issues, but also the biodiversity agenda. The judiciary has contributed immensely in its involvement in ensuring compliance with environmental impact assessment requirements, environmental norms, standards and procedures, and implementation of biodiversity laws. The judiciary continues to contribute through prosecution and adjudication of environmental crimes, such as poaching, illegal trade in wildlife, illegal logging, illegal fishing, and the list goes on. So, and through the judicial review and adjudication of environmental disputes, or participation in legal research analysis of case laws, we know members of the judiciary are in any preempt position to increase the visibility of environmental stewardship in general and the success of the conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity. So your independent actions and opinions in favor of environmental rule of law will help the general public to be more aware of the consequences of biodiversity loss and be able to put biodiversity consideration in the forefront of all social, economic, and political actions, including development actions. And the upcoming global biodiversity framework is expected to be a global guide for local action. So the means of collaboration among governments, organizations, civil society, general public will be key. As discussed in this very symposium, strengthening judicial interdependence and integrity is a prerequisite for the prevalence of environmental rule of law. So is legal education in the area of environmental law. As an independent branch, not affected by short-term political pressures to support unsustainable practices, the judiciary is well-placed to make difficult but necessary decisions. Biodiversity issues almost always involve other areas of law. The judiciary may be called upon to find a balance between competing priorities of different public entities or different levels of government, or reconcile a variety of sector-specific laws and regulations which may not take into account the interconnected nature of biodiversity or ecosystem or production systems. So the world needs the vital role of the judiciary more than ever. And this symposium and similar forums are undoubtedly shaping your role as an impartial arbiter in reconciling conservation needs with economic and development interests. Whether functioning in courts or tribunals or in investigations, inspection or prosecution, in the field of legal education, your role and contribution is indispensable. I appeal to you to continue to extend and enhance your professional support in the area of compliance and enforcement of international environmental treaties ratified or acceded to by many of your own national governments. Your role, your skills, not only as members of the judiciary, but also as members of the broader society, are certainly critical factors for governments and communities to succeed in their efforts to implement also the upcoming global biodiversity framework. The society at large will be looking upon you, the judges, to appropriately interpret the law, enforce the law, push for gaps in the law to be filled, and thus contribute to the conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity, and ensuring the equitable distribution of its benefits to all, in particular, to the vulnerable and marginalized groups. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Elizabeth, for your wise words, for your words of encouragement, but also for sharing with us your current work as the Executive Secretary for the Global for the Convention on Biological Diversity. Maybe not all of you know what the overall vision is for the new global framework on global biodiversity framework. It's been a long day. It is living in harmony with nature by 2050. That's the overall vision for what is being negotiated now by 196 parties by 2050. But we don't have time until 2050 to solve all the problems. We have a very small window of opportunity. And this is what science tells us. In order to be able to reach those global goals by 2050 on climate change, on biodiversity, on pollution, what has to happen are these transformative changes, systemic changes that need to be put in motion now in order to have a chance to get there by 2050, because things take time. And what is better suited to get these transformative changes on their way than the law? The law, the governance tool that guides behavior and provides justice to all, as you said, Elizabeth. Elizabeth, thank you for your words. But most of all, we would like to wish you best of luck in your most important function to get this global biodiversity framework adopted this year. The world needs it. The world needs you. We wish you best of luck and would like to thank you for your dedicated work. Thank you, Elizabeth.